you are. And it's a new horizon. Oh, I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come to.
All right. How are you? There's some outlines up here. They're from last week. If you had one from last week, you don't need to take one. If you do, then there's a few up here. All right. Everybody doing okay?
I don't know about everybody. But I am.
Me too.
Kevin, you're always okay, man. The eternal optimist. Yeah. I love it, man. Kevin, the world needs more people like you.
I agree. Yes, they do. I try to be more like him.
All right, let's go ahead. Let me share a few announcements with you guys, and then we'll get into the prayer. You guys listen like my kids used to when I was home. I'd say something, people just keep talking, it didn't matter. Yeah, I know. All right, so ladies, tomorrow night's Bunko, 6:30 right here. That reminds me, after study, if I could get some of the guys or strong ladies to help maybe tear down that side of the room in terms of chairs, that would be a blessing. If you could help me with that, that'd be great. 15 holding luncheons this Friday at 12:30. If I remember right, it's croissants and chicken salad. I can't remember anything, but I can remember that. Like, that's stuck in my head. Yeah, you probably did. Yeah, croissant. Yeah, that's probably right. Yeah. Another opportunity to eat men's prayer breakfast this Saturday at 8 o'clock. So if you haven't signed up for that, make sure you do that. Terry's not here tonight, but let me know and I'll pass it on to him if you're planning to come and you haven't signed up yet. This weekend on Sunday, we've got an informational meeting for a Oaxaca mission trip that we're tentatively planning for late September, early October. So if you just want to gather more information on that, come to this meeting after service in the high school room, and I'll share that with you, and then we'll pray together whether or not this year the Lord wants us to go, because I'm not settled on that yet. And then baptisms on the 28th of April, so if you want to follow the Lord in baptism, that's going to be the next chance to do that. Make sure you get signed up for that quickly. And then if you aren't part of a dinner group and would like to be in our dinner groups, make sure you sign up. There's a, on the bulletins or over on the little table over there, There's a place you can sign up. The only reason for you to sign up is if you're changing something. You want to be involved and you weren't. You were involved and you don't want to be. Or you were hosting and you don't want to host. Or you'd like to host. Any change, sign up. If you're good, you don't need to do anything. Even you guys can handle that, doing nothing. All right. So let me, for those of you that maybe are here for the first time, what we do at the beginning of our study is we do a time of communal prayer where we just kind of pair up with people around us and pray over a few things together as a body. And so let me give you some things to pray about for the church. We've been asking God pretty much every week on Wednesday nights to help continue to build community here at Grace. And so let's keep asking God to do that, just building a loving, godly community here in our church. We're going to ask God to do that. I'd also like to pray over our praise team and our audiovisual teams. Just want to continue to lift them up in prayer. Praise the Lord for people who serve faithfully in those ministries. The praise team, they're here extra hours every Sunday working on stuff. And so thank the Lord for them. And God's starting to bring some more people, more players and singers to that group. So praise the Lord for that. I know there's some others that are thinking about getting involved as well. So just pray God would move in their hearts to do that if that's what he wants. And then just for the guys and gals that are back in that little room that we stick them in every week, they only get noticed if something goes wrong. And so let's just pray for them and praise God for the people that do that. I also want to pray over our discipleship ministry. It's just a huge part of our church, and we've got a number of people being discipled right now, and we praise God for those people that are being discipled, and we want more people to get involved in that and get taught the Word of God on both sides, by the way. People going through the material, people who are need to be discipling as well. So let's pray over that ministry. And then let's also just pray for our Sunday school classes, whether that's back with the little ones on a Sunday morning. We had, it's 10 and down basically back there in the mornings. We had 9 kids on Sunday back there, Carrie and I did. So praise the Lord for that. We need a bigger table. I love when that happens. And so let's pray with not only that, but the teens also. And then, Scott's class back here on Sunday morning, he's doing a wonderful job. I think you guys are enjoying that fellowship back there with him. And so I just want to lift all of them up in prayer. It takes a lot of hard work and preparation to get ready to do those things. And so we want to just lift those things up to the Lord. All right. So team up with the people around you. Pray for about 5 minutes, and I'll come back and we'll pray over some missions things. All right, gang, let's continue in a time of prayer. We're going to pray over some things related to missions now, just around the world. Tonight we're going to be praying for the continent of South America. We're asking God to raise up laborers to do a work in South America. And so let's mention that continent by name. Also, I mentioned in the announcements that we're considering taking a mission trip to Oaxaca this fall. If you would just lift that up with me collectively here tonight and ask that God would give us direction in terms of whether or not to do that, and then whomever he would have to go on that trip would make that decision, and God would provide for them to be able to do that. And so those things I'd like us to pray for. I'd also like us to just lift up the country of Israel. If we could do that tonight, all the stuff that's been going on over there this week, it's just continuing to escalate over there. And so let's pray for Israel tonight. And specifically, we have a missionary that we support, Craig Hartman, that ministers in Israel. He's based out of New York City, but he goes over into Israel and does a lot of work there. And so in his most recent letter, this is just from a few days ago, he sent out some prayer requests that I'd like to mention for him today. He mentions in this letter that through all the stuff that had been going on in the Gaza Strip, that they had come in contact with a family where one of their relatives, I think a child, a son, an adult son, had been taken hostage in Gaza. And so the mother of this individual is not in good health. And so they're trying to care for her and minister to her as she goes through this ordeal. But he mentions a few things to pray specifically over that situation. The first one is that the Lord would rescue this young person who's being held hostage in Gaza. Secondly, if God wills, that the mother would stay alive long enough to be reunited with her loved one. Thirdly, that the Lord would continue to grant them wisdom as they minister and encourage the people in that area in a very challenging time. And then most importantly, he says, fourth thing is for the souls of this entire family, a mother, father, and their hostage loved one, that they would come to know Jesus as Savior. So that's a real deal over there. So let's make sure we're praying for them about these things. And so just to review, continent of South America, Oaxaca mission trip, Israel generally, and then pray for Craig and his team as they're ministering over in Israel. Okay? All right. 5 minutes, pray for those things, and we'll get on with the study. here. Help yourself, please. All right, guys, let's why don't you join me one more time in prayer before we start our study. Let's pray. Father, thank you for allowing us to come into your presence tonight. Lord, you're a gracious and a good God, and Lord, you are a God that desires to provide help in times of need. And Lord, I know there are needs all over the room tonight, different ways, different things, different situations. But there's not a person here that doesn't have something in their life that they need you to work. Lord, I just pray you would be at work. Father, we thank you for the chance to be here tonight, to gather, to worship, to learn, to grow. Lord, we thank you for this ministry. We thank you for this church and the work that it does. But Lord, it's all because of you and for you. And I just pray that you would work mightily in this church and through this body for your honor and glory. Lord, we lift up the music ministry here at Grace, Lord. We pray continue to bless that group and grow that group. And we pray that it would just be Sunday mornings and Sunday nights when we sing, whenever that is, Lord, it would just be a blessed time of worship and glorifying of your name. Lord, we pray for those individuals that are being discipled here at Grace, those who need to be discipled, those who are discipling, Lord, grow them and raise up another generation of people that are serious about following you with their life. Lord, we pray for the fellowship that we have in Sunday schools, whether that's the little ones or the teens or the adults, Lord, just bless those that are teaching. Guide them in what you desire to have them teach and use that time to instruct and build community here at Grace. Lord, we do pray over the situation in Israel. We lift that up to you. You tell us to pray for peace in Israel. Lord, we know that that is a battleground and has been for centuries. Lord, we know why. We understand that. And Lord, we know that ultimate peace won't come until you return, but Lord, we pray for that group of people. We pray that they would come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ first and foremost. Lord, that's what they need. But Lord, we pray for Craig and his team as they minister in that place, and pray for this family that he brought before us in his letter. Pray you'd work in that situation to bring them to a saving knowledge of Christ and horrible situation that they're dealing with. I can't imagine what they're going through, but I pray that in it they would see you. And that they're missing their son. They're worried about their son. Help them to understand that your son died for them. And Father, I ask that you would raise up laborers to minister in the continent of South America. Lord, it's a place that needs the gospel desperately. Lord, I pray for the Shearouses, who we already support in Brazil. I pray you would minister through them and encourage them. And I appreciate their faithfulness over the years. And Lord, as we open your word tonight, I pray that you would instruct us, help us to grow as a result of our time of being in your presence in your word. We ask it in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. Well, we are, or have been, for the last several months going through a study we're calling the Big Picture Bible Study, where we're trying to get just an overview of how the Old Testament fits together. After we take a break over the summer, we'll pick up and do the New Testament in the fall. But we've broken the Old Testament down into 12 major events and 12 major people or people groups. And we're on section 10, which is called Till All Split in Two. And so we've been talking about the nation of Israel. And after David and Solomon, at the end of Solomon's reign, the nation of Israel has really gone downhill, to say the least. And when Solomon's son, Rehoboam, takes over, God actually splits the nation of Israel into two different kingdoms. One is called Israel, the other called Judah. And so we just started to get into that last week and how come that took place. We saw a number of reasons, not the least of which was the idolatry that they had fallen into. Solomon himself had fallen into idolatry. He had started to tax the people of Israel to a large extent to build the different things that he had going on around that country. And so as he comes to the end of his life, many of the people of Israel are revolting. They try and keep it together. They ask Rehoboam if he'll give them some leniency, if he'll lighten their load, and he refuses. We'll get into that in just a moment. But God divides that kingdom. And so that's where we are. What I want to do tonight is talk about the first two kings of each nation. We're going to talk about the first king of Israel, which is Jeroboam, and then the first king of Israel under the split, which is Rehoboam. I know, I get it. It can be a little confusing, which is which, right? Who goes where with whom? I understand that. But we'll look at them a little bit, talk about who they were, what they did, some of the things that they did. And then we'll spend a little time, not much, but a little time talking through some of the charts that are in the notes I gave you. I'm giving you these for your personal study. So you can take these home and kind of digest it on your own and take a little look at it. But I'll walk you through some of that. And then if time permits, I'm going to pick one of my favorite kings out of that Judah list, and we'll just spend a little time learning something practical from his life, if we have time. Most likely we won't, knowing me. But we'll give it a shot. How about that? So let's first talk about Jeroboam. Turn with me in your Bibles to 1 Kings chapter 11. 1 Kings chapter 11. Let's see who Jeroboam was. 1 Kings chapter 11. And let's read a little bit about him beginning in verse 26. So 1 Kings 11. In verse 26, it says this, "And Jeroboam, the son of Nebat, an Ephrathite of Zerda, Solomon's servant." So there it is. Jeroboam was Solomon's servant, whose mother's name was Zerah, a widow woman. Even he lifted up his hand against the king. And this was the cause that he lifted up his hand against the king. Solomon built Milo. That was one of the building projects that Solomon had going on, and repaired the breaches of the city of David, his father. 28. And the man Jeroboam was a mighty man of valor. And Solomon, seeing the young man that he was industrious, he made him ruler over all the charge of the house of Joseph. Now, as you read that, it could be a little confusing because of the way it's laid out. It almost seems like He was his servant, and then he rose up and rebelled, and then he saw he was a mighty man, so he put him over the charge of this. That's not the middle verse is an interjection. He was the servant of Solomon. He was one of his guys. He was a mighty man. Solomon saw that he was a mighty man, and so Solomon put him over, as he calls it in verse 28, because he was a young man that was industrious. He made him ruler over the charge of the house of Joseph. And so he had some responsibilities in the kingdom of Solomon to care for the house of Joseph. But at some point in time, as Solomon builds Milo, again, I don't know what it was specifically that caused him to have an issue with that, but I think it's evident that there was a heavy taxation that was causing everybody a problem. And so he rebels, lifts his hand up against Solomon. And after this, look at verse 29. It says, And it came to pass that time when Jeroboam went out of Jerusalem, that the prophet Ahijah, the Shilonite, found him in the way. And he had clad himself with a new garment, and they too were alone in the field. And Ahijah caught the new garment that was on him and rent it into 12 pieces. And he said to Jeroboam, "Take thee 10 pieces, for thus saith the Lord, the God of Israel, behold, I will rend the kingdom out of the hand of Solomon and will give 10 tribes to thee." Verse 32, "But he shall have one tribe for my servant David's sake and for Jerusalem's sake, the city which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel." We'll deal with that last part in a bit, okay? But I want you to see here that God sends a prophet to Jeroboam, and he takes his garment off and rips it, rents it into 12 pieces, and tells Jeroboam that he is going to be over 12 or 10 of the tribes of Israel, okay? The 10, what are called northern tribes. Now, those 10 tribes consist of Reuben, Simeon, Dan, Naphtali, you writing this down? Gad, Asher, Issachar, Zebulun, Manasseh, and Ephraim, okay? I'll read them again. Reuben, Simeon, Dan, Naphtali, Gad, Asher, Issachar, Zebulun, Manasseh, Ephraim. Now, Levi, the tribe of Levi, is excluded from that, okay? They were the priestly tribe. They didn't have an inheritance, a land inheritance in Israel. They were the priests. And so you have those 10 plus Levi, which is excluded. And then, as I said in a moment ago, we'll get to the part that it says that Rehoboam got one. Okay, we'll see that in a second. So we got 10 plus 1 is 11, and then one more is under Rehoboam is 12. Okay, yes. Yeah, they replaced him. Yeah, it's a different question for a different time. But yeah. Yeah. The tribes change a lot in Scripture. We went through that when we came through the 12 tribes. If you can kind of backtrack and see the videos, I showed you different places where they use different 12. But one of them replaces Joseph, and one of them replaced Levi of his two sons. Yeah. Okay, so Solomon tries to kill Jeroboam. Look at that in verse 40. And Solomon sought therefore to kill Jeroboam. All right, so he finds out about this prophecy, and he's trying to kill Jeroboam. And Jeroboam arose and fled into Egypt unto Shishak. That's right next to Shake Shack, king of Egypt, and was in Egypt until the death of Solomon. Okay, so who does that remind? Does that remind you of anybody? It does remind you a little bit of Moses, but Solomon trying to kill him. Saul, right? Saul and David. That was Saul tried to kill David multiple times when he found out he was going to be replacing him. And so Solomon does the same thing when he finds out what's going on with Jeroboam. Now, let's turn a little bit further. Look in chapter 12. We went through last time and talked about the fact that Jeroboam comes to Rehoboam and tries to get him to lighten their load. And remember, he took counsel from the older counselors who sat with his father Solomon. He ignores their counsel. They gave him good counsel, but he ignores that. And then he goes to his peers, the guys he grew up with, and they're like, yeah, really give it to him, you know. Make their burden heavier. My father chastised you with whips. I'll chastise you with scorpions. I mean, he's really letting them have it, right? And so as a result of that, he loses the kingdom and they flee. And we have no part of Israel anymore. And he goes and sets up his own kingdom. But look in chapter 12 and look at verse 25 as he's establishing this kingdom. It says in verse 25, then Jeroboam built Shechem in Mount Ephraim, and dwelt therein, and went out from thence, and built Penuel, or Penuel. And Jeroboam said in his heart, now shall the kingdom return to the house of David, if this people go up to do sacrifice in the house of the Lord at Jerusalem, then shall the heart of this people turn again unto their Lord, even unto Rehoboam, king of Judah, and they shall kill me and go again to Rehoboam, king of Judah. And so he's setting up this new kingdom, and he recognizes, there's a potential problem here, that as the people of Israel go to Jerusalem, and they were required under the Jewish law to go back there three times each year. If you want to read about that, you can look in Deuteronomy 16, 16. There were three different feasts where they were all to come to Jerusalem to celebrate the feast. And so he's worried, even though they're part of my kingdom, if they go back to Jerusalem and they see God moving in that place, their heart is going to go back and want to be part of the kingdom under Rehoboam. So he's worried about losing his kingdom. And so he devises this plan. Look at verse 28. Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Behold, thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. Okay. Anybody see any problems in that verse? Where shall we begin? He comes up with this ingenious plan, right? All right, so here's what we're going to do. To keep them from going down to Jerusalem, we're going to establish a couple of places to worship. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to make two calves of gold. Anybody else do that before in Scripture? Aaron did that, didn't he? Remember when Moses is up on Mount Sinai getting the law? The people beg Aaron to make them gods. Moses has been gone like 40 days on the mount. They don't know what's going on. And so they ask him to fashion them calves that are calf that they can worship. And it's interesting that the phrase that he uses at the end of verse 28, when he says to them, behold thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. That's in Exodus 32:4. That's the exact same phrase that Aaron uses when he builds the calves. It just shows you who's behind that whole thing. But notice this. Look in 28 again. Whereupon the king took counsel and made two calves of gold and said unto them, he's saying this to the people, it is too much for you to go up to Jerusalem. Too hard. Hey, that's a long walk, man. It is too hard for you to go to Jerusalem. Let me make this more convenient for you. Can I just tell you, you ought to be wary of religion or churches that try and make everything easy for you, convenient for you. Following Jesus sometimes is not convenient. It's just not. Sometimes it requires great diligence, stress, hardship, discipline. It's not always easy. Now, listen, the life of a sinner is much harder than the life of a believer in Christ. But being a Christ follower is not always convenient. Okay? And so here he's trying to build a religion based in convenience, right? That appeals to our flesh for sure. Man, we're all lazy. You say, well, I'm not lazy. You are about something. You might go to the gym every day. You might be really diligent about your diet. You might not spend too much time in a lazy boy chair watching TV, but you got a closet somewhere stuffed with junk that you don't want to clean up. We all do, right? And it's easy for me to say, well, I'm disciplined in this area and point at your undisciplinedness in that area and think I'm better than you. But the reality is I got, again, my junk drawer or closet full of junk in my house somewhere too. But understand that the easy way is not always the right way, okay? It's just not. Verse 29, and he set one in Beth-El, and the other put he in Dan. Okay, so he takes one of these golden calves, and he puts it in the city of, or the place of Beth-El. Anybody know what Beth-El means? House of God. That's exactly right, Beth-El. When you see the word Beth in Scripture, it means house. Like Bethlehem is the house of bread. Beth-El is the house of God. Anybody know where Beth-El first got its name? Anybody remember that story? It was Jacob, exactly right. Jacob in Genesis chapter 28, verses 16 to 22. That's where he's fleeing, and he encounters God in that place, and he says, this is the house of God. It's Beth-El. Isn't it interesting that he puts a golden calf there? That was a place of religious significance to the nation of Israel. They held that place in high regard because of its history under Jacob. And so it's no coincidence that he's putting a golden calf there for them to come to worship. Now, Beth-El is about 10 miles north of Jerusalem. So they can come down, but they're not going to quite go down to Jerusalem. They got another 10 miles to, for us, it's like 10 miles, piece of cake, man. That's no problem. Yeah, try walking it. You'd be like, yeah, Beth-El sounds good. The other one it says he puts in Dan. Now, Dan, first of all, and I'm not going to chase this rabbit, but the tribe of Dan's a mess throughout Scripture, first of all. But also, the city of Dan is the northernmost city in Israel, okay? That's the northernmost city. So he put one at the top and one just above Jerusalem, kind of towards the middle. So wherever you lived in that place, you had somewhere to go that was convenient for you to get to. And so he takes these calves and he puts them there, and the people of Israel come to these places rather than going down to Jerusalem to worship. And that was his whole intention. And so obviously there was great animosity between the Israelites and those of the tribe of Judah because of this. They're just further falling into that pagan ritual. But let me show you something else. Just a few pages later, look in chapter 13 and look at verse 32. 1 Kings 13:32. For the saying which he cried by the word, this is a prophet coming in, by the way, and prophesying against what's going on. For the saying of which he cried by the word of the Lord against the altar in Beth-El, and against all the houses of the high places, look at this, which are in the cities of Samaria, shall surely come to pass. In the New Testament, we see animosity between the Jews and what are called the Samaritans. Yeah? You can read about that in John chapter 4. That's where Jesus has the encounter with the woman by the well, who's a Samaritan. And we just quickly ascribe that animosity to the fact that the Samaritans were, for lack of a better, more politically correct way of saying it, they were half-breeds. They were a mixture of races. They were where Jews had mixed with Gentiles, okay? And so that's why they had this. And that's certainly part of it, for sure. But the other part's here. These cities of Samaria were places of paganism, idol worship, worshiping these golden calves. And so that also contributes to the problem that the people of Judah had with the people of Samaria. Okay? And so this is how Jeroboam's kingdom starts, by instituting paganism in the nation of Israel, the northern tribes of Israel. And he is, as you can see on the chart, I think it's on the back of your notes, this chart here. He's the first of 19 wicked kings, right-hand column, in the nation of Israel. So he's the first one out of the gate, and then 18 people after him, all bad. Now, there are degrees of badness, but they're all bad, okay? And he's the first one out of the gate. That kingdom eventually ends by going into captivity under the Assyrians. Now, we'll get into that next time. We'll talk about the captivity next time. But that's how that whole progression ends, by them going into captivity. All right, so let's turn our attention now to Rehoboam. That was Jeroboam. Now, let's talk about Rehoboam. I know some of you out there that might still have children in your future, you're really contemplating, should we go Jeroboam? Should we go Rehoboam? Twins would be good. That'd be awesome. Just Rehoboam and Jeroboam. not quite as good as the people in the Bible, Huzz and Buzz. You ever seen that name? I love those names. Huzz and Buzz. If I had twins, I would have definitely named them Huzz and Buzz. How could you not? It's awesome. So let's look at Rehoboam. Look in 1 Kings chapter 11 and look at verse 43 just to kind of see where he comes into his reign. Verse 43, and Solomon slept with his father, so Solomon has died, and was buried in the city of David his father, and Rehoboam his son reigned in his stead. Okay, so there's where we see him taking the throne. And we've kind of already talked about this a little bit last time, and I even mentioned it just a moment ago. Right out of the gate, he has the opportunity as Jeroboam and the other Israelites come to him and they're saying, hey, listen, your dad did us wrong. If you'll lighten our load, so to speak, and do what's right, we'll serve you. And he doesn't do it. He comes back with a harsh answer. He rejects, look at verse 8 of chapter 12:8. And he forsook the counsel of the old men. Those are the old counselors that counseled his father, which they had given him, and consulted with the young men that were grown up with him and which stood before him. And so there you have it. He discards their wise counsel. He doesn't want to listen to the old guys. He wants to listen to his peers, the guys he grew up with. And they give him bad counsel, and he increases their burden. In fact, I made reference to this earlier. Let's read it. Look in same chapter, chapter 12. Look at verse 14. Let's 14. And spake to them after the counsel of the young men. So he's answering Jeroboam here, saying, my father made your yoke heavy, and I will add to your yoke. So their burden, their yoke, that thing they're carrying, a yoke was on their shoulders, right? My father also chastised you with whips, and I will chastise you with scorpions. How to win friends and influence people, right there. He's got it down. Wherefore the king hearkened not unto the people, for the cause was from the Lord, that he might perform the saying which the Lord spake by Ahijah. Remember, we read this earlier. That's when he takes the garment and tears it, right? The Shilonite unto Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. So God's obviously working and orchestrating behind the scenes in all of this. But that's how Rehoboam comes out of the gate. And so he gets the southern, what is typically referred to as the southern tribes of Israel. And that consists of one, we saw that in chapter 11 and verse 32. Remember that? Let's read that again. Chapter 11 and verse 32. He says, but he shall have one tribe for my servant David's sake. So it's David's tribe. That's the tribe of Judah. Okay? And for Jerusalem's sake, the city which I have chosen out of all the tribes of Israel. So we know that David was the apple of God's eye. God had a soft spot for David, and he made a covenant with David that he would never have someone not ruling, not sitting on the throne, all right? So that obviously culminates in Jesus Christ being born, who's of the lineage of David, of the tribe of Judah. But he says that one tribe he'll have, but it's, you know, so the math doesn't work, does it? He gave him 10 parts. We know Levi is excluded. And so he gets one. How do we get to 12? Or that gets us to 12, right? But then also, something weird happens here. Look in 12:21. Because there's a tribe. I don't know if you caught it when I read that those names. Probably not, because I read them quick. But look at this, 21. 12:21. And when Rehoboam was come to Jerusalem, he assembled all the house of Judah with the tribe of Benjamin, and 84,000 chosen men, etc. Benjamin wasn't in the 10 that went north, but he also just told him, hey, you're just getting one, and that one is Judah. But then later we see Benjamin coming alongside and coupling with Judah. And so usually when people talk about the 10 northern tribes and the two southern tribes, The two are Judah and Benjamin, and that's not a wrong way of looking at it, but I don't think God included Benjamin in that breakup originally. Why? Well, that's a bit of a question, but I have a suspicion, and I think it's a good one. If you maybe you recall this, maybe you don't, but you can certainly go back and read it. In Judges 19 and Judges 20, you see the tribe of Benjamin commit some of the most horrific crimes that you have ever seen anyone commit. I'm not even going to talk about it again. You can read it on your own. They're responsible for horrific crime. As a result of that crime, the entire nation of Israel comes together and attacks Benjamin and ends up virtually wiping out the entire tribe. And then they make a little side covenant with them over here. You can read it on your own. I'm not going to get into all that. But it could be, and I suspect that it is, that they're being excluded from this equation because of that act. Remember, I told you that those 12 tribes move in Scripture. They're different in different places based upon what's going on. But why does Benjamin couple up with Judah in this? I think personally, this is a bit speculative, but I think personally it could be related to something way back in the book of Genesis. Look in Genesis chapter 43 and verse 9. So this is the story involving the nation of Israel, the sons of Israel. And remember, as the brothers had sold Joseph into Egypt, right? They're running out of food. They go down. They have their face-to-face with Joseph. They still don't know it's Joseph. He lets them go, but he says, if you come back, you got to bring your younger brother, Benjamin, which would have been his full brother. The rest of them are his half-brothers. Benjamin was his full brother, and he wants to see him. And so Jacob, Israel, was with good reason reluctant to send Benjamin with his older sons. I think he had his suspicions about what had happened to Joseph. And so Judah steps up, and look at verse 8. And Judah said to Israel, his father, send the lad with me, and I will arise and go, that we may live and not die, both we and thou, and also our little ones. I will be surety for him. Of my hand shalt thou require him. If I bring him not unto thee and set him before thee, then let me bear the blame forever. And so I suspect that Benjamin, at least maybe in part, goes with Judah on the basis of that promise. When Judah raised his ancestor raised his hand and said, I'll take care of Benjamin. I'll look out for him. If something happens to him, it's on me, and you can take my life for his. And so whether that's the case or not the case, Benjamin comes alongside of Judah, and they establish the two southern tribes in the kingdom of Judah. And so on your chart, again, on that same chart that's on the back of your notes, on the left-hand column, you see the kings of Judah, beginning with Rehoboam. And Rehoboam is the first in a list of 20 kings or queen. There's one queen stuffed in there. You see her, number 7. And the majority of them are not great. 8 of them are pretty good. And so in this chart, you can see the little asterisk, it's a star. Those are indicating the 8 good kings in the nation of Israel, the ones that did well. This chart, I think, is also helpful in the sense that it shows you, first of all, some of the aliases. In other words, other names that these kings went by. Sometimes you'll be reading and you'll go, wait, who was that? And so it's them being called by a different name, an alias. Like, what's my name? No. It's Gary. You didn't know that, did you? I'm named after my dad. My dad's name's Gary, but I've never been called Gary my entire life. I've always been called Brad. My middle name is Bradford, which is my mom's maiden name. And so I've gone by Brad my entire life. If you call the house and you say, can I speak to Gary Nelson? I'll know you're a salesperson and I will hang up on you. So it's a great benefit that way. But legally, my name's Gary, but I go by Brad. So it's an alias, right? It's a nickname of sorts. And so I'm sure many of you don't go by your legal name. Maybe you go by a shortened version of your, probably Nicholas, right? Back there in the back row, Nicholas, right? And he goes by Nick, right? So we understand that. And so these kings had the same thing. It also shows you where some of the kings in the different Judah and Israel had the same name, because sometimes that can be confusing, right? You're like, wait a minute, I thought this guy was on the other side. Yeah, he was. It's, believe it or not, people can have the same name, even though they're not the same person. I mentioned the queen, Atalia, or Talia. She was, as suspected, the daughter of Ahab. Now, if you know the Bible at all, you know Ahab. He was bad news, man. He's probably the wicked, most wicked of all the wicked. He's the bad. His wife Jezebel was even worse than him. And so they had a child that married over into the kingly line of Judah. Bad move. But it happened. And so she steps in and rules for a little while. Doesn't last long. She's quickly overthrown. But hopefully this chart can at least give you a visual, kind of show you the lineage and some of the comparisons and who was good and who was not. The other chart I gave you, this is actually out of the Thompson Chain Reference Bible. It's not original to me at all. But this little chart just kind of shows you the peaks and valleys of the kings of Judah. Now, this one only deals with the kings of Judah, not Israel, okay? And it points out the eight good kings, quote unquote, good kings. You can see them numbered there with the little bubbles and numbers inside of them. And you can see, you know, where the pits are and where the peaks are with some references. And then the next sheet is really just a description. This sheet here is just a description of for that chart. Okay. So you get a brief little summary of each one of the 20 kings or queen of Judah. Okay. So again, I'm giving you this for your personal study. Okay. We don't have time to go through all of those, but we do have a few minutes left, about 10 minutes. So I want to talk about the last good king in Judah. And he's one of my favorites. He has been for decades. His name is Josiah. He's one of my favorites. And so I'm going to turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Chronicles 34. Second Chronicles chapter 34. Let's just point out a few things maybe we can challenge ourselves with tonight from Josiah. So verse 1, 34:1, Josiah was 8 years old when he began to reign, and he reigned in Jerusalem 1 and 31 years. Can you imagine? 8 years old. I was still struggling to tie my shoes, probably. My goodness, and he's the king. He's the king of Judah. And so look what it says here. Look at the next verse. And he did that which was right. That's a good sign. In the sight of the Lord. Here's the thing I want us to see. And walked in the ways of David, his father, and declined neither to the right hand nor to the left. And so the first thing I want you to notice about Josiah is he finds for himself a positive role model to follow. It says that he walked in all the ways of David, his father. David was not his father. Now, obviously, he's his great, 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 I don't even know how many, but great, up the line grandfather for sure. But if you study the life of Josiah, what you're going to notice is that his father, his dad, was a king named Amon, A-M-O-N, and his grandfather was a king named Manasseh. They are two of the most wicked kings that you'll find in the kingdom of Judah. So, what's Josiah do? He looks past them because their example stunk. And he finds somebody worth emulating. And the thing that strikes me is I think that's a great role model for us to follow. Because there's probably not a person in here that can't look in your past and point fingers at a situation or a person and say, I am the way I am because of them or because of that. And I'm not discounting that in the least. That's a heavy burden and hard to deal with. But there's also all around us wonderful examples of what it means to follow Christ. The scripture is filled with examples of what it means to live a godly life. And so if you want someone worth emulating, you don't have to look too far to find somebody. God will bring somebody into your life worth following. But it's just easier for us to oftentimes go, it's their fault that I am the way I am or that I'm dealing with what I'm dealing with, and then use it as an excuse to make ourselves a victim for the situation that we're in. And again, I'm not discounting the difficult things that people have to deal with. I'm not discounting that at all. I get it. I walk with people through that. I've walked through some of that in my own life. But we can also find many examples of people worth following their role that model that they give us. And Josiah did that. Let's keep going. Verse 3. And in the eighth year of his reign, how old is he now? That's good math. Way to go. For in the eighth year of his reign, while he was yet young, he began to seek after the Lord, the God of David, his father. Okay? And so at 16 years old, we see him desiring to want to know God more. He's seeking after God. He's been king for 8 years, but now at 16, he's wanting more of a relationship with God. And so, I mean, think about it. He's king. You can't do much better than that. It's good to be king. But even in that role, he understands, I need God. I need a relationship with God. And he's seeking God. He's making God his priority, seeking him. And so let's keep reading. I stopped about halfway through that verse. Look at, and in the 12th year, tougher math, what do you got now? 20, way to go. He began to purge Judah and Jerusalem from the high places and the groves. Those would have been places of idolatry. And of the carved images and the molten images. And so at age 20, he's desiring to do something for God. He's starting to clean up the countryside around Judah, getting rid of all the paganism. And here's the principle that I think is a good one. We can love God, and we can even do things for God, which he's doing. I believe he loves God. He's seeking God. He's trying to do things for God. But his relationship with God can only go so far without a relationship with a book, which we're about to see. It wasn't until God's word got introduced into his life and became real to him, meaningful to him, that he started to really do some serious things for God. Again, the world is filled with people that I genuinely believe love God. They know God, they're saved, and they desire to do good things for God, but they don't understand the directions. It'd be like putting something together without the directions. Could you do it? You'd probably figure it out. It's going to take you a lot longer. Probably not be as good. Lots of mistakes along the way. Certainly helps if we have the written instructions that we can follow. And so he does end up finding a book. I'll kind of summarize here because we're a little low on time. But they're doing some renovations around the temple. They've collected funds for that, and they're sending those funds, and the king wants a progress report on how the construction project is coming. And while they're doing the construction project, they find a copy of the law, a written copy of God's word, their Bible. Nobody had one of those. They find it hidden in the church, which is kind of mind-blowing, right? It's like, what? But they find a copy of God's word, and the king, or it's brought back to the king, and he has it read before him. And so let's see here how he responds to that. Look, let's look in verse 18. And Shaphan the scribe told the king, saying, "Hilkiah the priest hath given me a book." And Shaphan read it before the king. And it came to pass when the king heard the words of the law that he rent his clothes. This is the first time he's ever heard it read. And he just takes his garment and rips it. Skip down a little bit later. Verse 27. This is as God comes back and starts to talk to him about what he did. He says, "Because thine heart was tender, and thou didst humble thyself before God, when thou heardest the words against this place and against the inhabitants thereof, and humbledest thyself before me, and didst rend thy clothes and weep before me, I have even heard thee also, saith the Lord." He is worried that they're under the judgment of God, because they've been violating the scripture. They'd been living in violation of God's word. But I want you to see the threefold response or attitude that he has toward God's word when he hears it. Look at verse 27. The first thing it says, "Because thine heart was tender." He has a heart that's soft towards God's word. He's willing to change his life to line up with what God's word says. One of the worst things that we can do is become hard-hearted towards God's word. To come with presupposition in our heart. We need to come softly, tenderly. Notice also it says, "And thou didst humble thyself before God." He humbles himself before God. Now think about that. He's a 20-ish something-year-old guy. We all know how 20-year-olds are. So I think everybody in here, I'm looking around, probably out of their 20s now, so I can say that without fear of getting beat up. Some of us are farther out of our 20s than others. And not only is he a 20-something, he's king. So it wouldn't be too far-fetched to think he could have just said, "Hey, you know what? I'm king. And by the way, I think I'm doing okay. I mean, look at all I've done. I've been cleaning this place up. I've been getting rid of the idols. I've been taking down the high places. I've been trying to clean up and seek God." He could have become very prideful, couldn't he have? But he wasn't. He was humble. Even though he was doing all those great things, even though he was a person in a position of power, he's still humble before God. And then finally, notice it says in that verse that he, down towards the end, he says, "And you did rend your clothes." I think that that rending of his garment, that tearing of his garment, represents repentance. It's a mourning, right? He's in essence dying to self. He said, even though they were doing okay, even though he was trying real hard, even though he was seeking the right things, he didn't know exactly how it was supposed to be done until he had a book that they found. And once he got the book, he's tender towards it, he's humble before God, and he's willing to turn and repent when God tells him to. Now, let's finish this way. We're out of time. No, we're not. Keep going. Look at verse 31. Real quick. "And the king stood in his place and made a covenant." Okay? So now he's going to make a covenant with God before the Lord to walk after the Lord. There's the first part. He's walking with God. You know, so you guys took walking for granted, most of you, when you came in, unless you got some kind of pain going on. How many of you walked in here going, "Left, right, left, right, left, right"? No, you just do it, right? You don't have to think about it. Sometimes we get on autopilot with God. Christianity becomes very cultural. We're in the Bible Belt, after all. We go to church. Even reading our Bible can become just a habit that we do every morning, like drinking a cup of coffee. He says, no, I'm walking with you. He's intentional about that. And then he says, and to keep his commandments. He's going to keep what he reads. He's going to keep the word of God. He's going to do it with all of his heart. Do you see that? And his testimonies and his statutes with all his heart. God becomes his main pursuit. No more divided heart. And then finally, and to perform the words of the covenant. So he's going to do it. He's going to perform it. He says, I'm going to walk with you. I'm going to keep your word, and I'm going to do it. The word of God does you no good if you're not willing to live it. Application is the key. You want to be transformed? Apply the Bible. Knowing the Bible won't transform you. You got to know it to do it. But if it doesn't ever go from knowing to doing, you'll never be transformed. And so you got to do it that way. Let's pray. We'll be done. Father, we love you. We thank you for Jesus. Appreciate your word. Appreciate the example of Josiah. And Lord, I just ask that you would help each of us to have the same heart he did towards your word. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.